Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the second in our series of Juvenile Justice Learning Communities. Today we're going to focus on residential care and behavioral health. I'm Jackie Green from the National Center for Mental Health and Juvenile Justice, and we are a partner in the National TA Network for Children's Behavioral Health, which is operated by the University of Maryland. And through that work, we are offering this learning community on juvenile justice and behavioral health. It's actually a series of webinars that are followed by office hours with the experts who have presented on the webinars, along with a self-assessment tool that you can use to think about how you're doing in each of the areas that we discuss on the webinar in your local community. So we had one webinar a few weeks ago on probation and behavioral health, and today we'll be talking about residential care. We're going to focus on how systems of care might be able to coordinate with your juvenile justice residential care system in order to meet the needs of young people. And we're going to give you some information about the behavioral health needs of kids who are in juvenile justice residential settings, as well as some screening instruments and assessment processes that are used in residential settings. As many of you probably are aware, there is a really high prevalence rate of behavioral health needs among kids who are involved in the juvenile justice system. We see that about 70% of them meet criteria for a mental disorder. Almost half of the juvenile justice-involved kids meet criteria for a substance use disorder. And nearly all of kids who are involved in the juvenile justice system have had some traumatic event exposure. And these rates are much higher than the rates we see among kids in the general population. And today we're talking about kids who end up in the very deepest end of the juvenile justice system. So you're going to hear some data and statistics from Georgia and New York about the prevalence rates that they see in their facilities. We know that these are kids who end up with the highest needs who are involved in the juvenile justice system. And we also know that systems of care and the framework that that provides could provide great support for these kids and their families. You'll hear today about the need for cross-systems collaboration in order to really effectively meet the needs of these young people. And as always, care for young people should be family-driven and youth-guided, culturally and linguistically competent. And we see youth and families who have a lot of multi-systems needs, and in fact, most of the young people who end up in residential care in the juvenile justice system have already been involved with many different systems before they come into the residential juvenile justice system. So there is great overlap in terms of the needs of this population and all the assets that systems of care has to provide to help meet those needs. We're going to hear from two folks today. Our first is Dr. Christine Doyle, who's the Director of Behavioral Health for the Georgia Department of Juvenile Justice, and she's going to give us some information about their population in Georgia and how they work with them. And then we will slide over to Dr. Irene Valentine from the New York State Office of Children and Family Services, who's going to talk about how the population looks and how they work with them in New York State. So we'll get right to it. I do want to let you know that you all are muted as participants, but we welcome your questions right in the public chat box, and feel free to put questions in there throughout the presentations. We're going to make sure that we have enough time for Christy and Irene to get through their presentations, and then we'll shift over to the questions that you've entered in the chat box and do some Q&A with them for the rest of the time we have together. So please feel free to type your questions in the chat box as we go along. And we will move right over to Dr. Christy Doyle. Christy?
Hi. Thanks very much, everybody. I appreciate you attending this afternoon. As Jackie said, I'm the Director of Behavioral Health for the Georgia Department of Juvenile Justice. A quick word about how our system looks. Unlike some other states in Georgia, the Department of Juvenile Justice is responsible for all detention, both short and long term. So essentially, any time a child goes behind a locked correctional door in Georgia, DJJ is the one with the key to the door. So as such, we have 26 secure facilities around the state. Seven of these are youth development campuses, which are our deepest end facilities and our long-term centers for adjudicated youth. 19 of them are what we call Regional Youth Detention Centers, or RYDCs, and these are our short-term pre-adjudication, pre-adjudication facilities, facilities for children who have been adjudicated and are awaiting some sort of residential placement, or children who are being tried as adults. So our capacity in our long-term centers ranges from 80 to 150 beds, and our capacity in our short-term centers from 30 to 200 beds. And we serve an average of about 1,400 kids in detention, both short and long-term, on any given day. The Department of Juvenile Justice is charged with providing all medical, mental health, and educational services to the children within our care, and my office is in charge of providing all behavioral health services. As such, we do have full treatment teams in all of our secure facilities, so every secure facility has at least one full-time master's level mental health clinician, some hours of psychology time, up to a full-time clinical director in our largest and long-term facilities, some hours of psychiatry time, a registered nurse who works closely with the psychiatrist, and substance abuse counselors in our long-term facilities, although we do provide prevention interventions in our short-term facilities for substance abuse as well. I'll run through this very, very quickly. These criteria are policy-driven. So any child who is in one of our short or long-term facilities is eligible to have ongoing mental health treatment if they are displaying suicidal thoughts, psychosis, mood, anxiety, trauma history. And the trauma history can be full or partially symptomatic for post-traumatic stress disorder, or the child could just have symptoms that are severe enough to be causing impairment without meeting full diagnostic criteria. In addition, all youth who need to take psychotropic medications while they are in one of our secure facilities is maintained on our mental health caseload. The treatment team determines what types of services the child will receive, and we'll talk a little bit more about what services are available. If a child was receiving services and appears to have stabilized, but we believe the child would destabilize without that level of support, they would also be eligible for placement on the mental health caseload. Any child who is being evaluated for competence to stand trial, and we'll talk a little bit more about our behavioral health placement review panel, but any child referred to that panel, which is the highest level of mental health review in our agency, must receive, obviously, ongoing mental health services. So this is a quick look at what our continuum looks like. Every child in every facility receives a screening within 2 hours of admission to a secure facility. And that screening covers mental health, substance abuse, and suicide risk factors. That includes children who transfer between secure facilities, who have been admitted recently. There are no limitations on that. So anytime a child walks inside the door of a secure facility to which he or she was not previously assigned, they would be rescreened. So last year that amounted to 11,720 screenings. And of those youth who were screened, almost 60% or 6,772 hit a cut score that required a mental health assessment, which we'll discuss in a minute. Kids can also self-refer via our help request process. And last year we had almost 5,000 help requests submitted. And of course we offer crisis management all the time. Anytime a kid might need it, no help request is required to access that service. So if a child has screened for mental health assessment or has put in a help request and requested to be assessed for mental health services, that youth must be assessed by a master's level mental health clinician within 72 hours of referral. And that is a hard and fast 72 hours that does not exclude evening and weekends, so we've had to staff accordingly and schedule accordingly. In addition, for the youth who are being admitted to a YDC, a long-term facility, we also administer a comprehensive mental health assessment that includes records review, interviews with parents and guardians, more extensive interviews with kids, and potentially some additional screenings. In addition, all kids who are admitted to a YDC are administered a trauma screening. Those options are available at a short-term center, but they are mandatory at the point of admission for a long-term center. And every child who is placed on the mental health caseload following their mental health assessment at the 72-hour mark is immediately referred for a psychodiagnostic evaluation. Kids who are on psychotropic medications or have been within the previous 3 months are seen by the psychiatrist, and all others are seen by the psychologist. And roughly half of the kids that we carry on our mental health caseloads take psychotropic medications of some sort. The remainder receive only talk therapies. So, in summary, for all kids, we offer suicide prevention, crisis intervention, and what we call special management planning, so additional strategies that are as much for direct care staff as they are for the kids to help manage difficult sorts of situations. For kids on the mental health caseload, we offer individual therapy, group therapy, medication management, obviously, treatment planning, and in some facilities, we offer activity and recreation therapies as well. So a few of the group and individual treatment models that we are offering right now. We are trying to make every effort to offer only evidence-based practices in our secure facilities, and are really glad that more of them are coming back online, or not back online, are coming online for kids involved specifically with juvenile justice. So right now we're offering the group-based intervention, structured psychotherapy for adolescents responding to chronic stress, or SPARCS, which is a group-based model for kids who have experienced complex trauma and has proved to be a favorite of both our kids and our treatment staff. The youth respond very, very well to this modality. In addition, we offer trauma-focused cognitive behavioral therapy, or TFCBT, and we do offer that primarily in our long-term centers, although our larger short-term centers also offer that. And then we have the New Freedom Treatment Program, which is a model that was developed utilizing behavioral or motivational enhancement therapy and cognitive behavioral therapy to help move kids through their stages of change in mental health, criminogenic risk, and other areas. In addition, we offer a model known as EQUIP. Perhaps some of you might be familiar with the ACT model, ART, A-R-T. You can tell I'm a mental health professional, not a criminal justice professional, but the ART, Aggression Replacement Training Model. EQUIP was developed by the same folks who developed ART, but it is a longer and more in-depth version of that program. And we use this exclusively at our long-term facilities. And finally, we offer 7 Challenges, which is a substance abuse treatment model. We chose this in collaboration with our Department of Behavioral Health and Developmental Disabilities here in Georgia. The two departments got together and chose a single model to help develop a continuum of care for kids who were moving in and out of the community in secure placements. So, quick numbers about who we serve numbers-wise. This was for our last fiscal year, which runs from July to June, so I'm getting ready to have a new year's worth of data. What we have seen over the year that is about to end is the YDC caseload numbers are going up. So last year it was about 50%. This year I expect it to be closer to 60%. And here are some diagnostic categories and pictures of what we see. So you can see roughly 84% of our kids qualify for some sort of substance use diagnosis, which is consistent with what we know about the risks for kids in juvenile justice or in contact. Conduct disorder or oppositional defiant disorder makes sense that our kids would have that or they wouldn't be in a secure facility. I will say that conduct or ODD are not by themselves sufficient to qualify a child for ongoing treatment on the mental health caseload. So all of those kids with conduct disorder or ODD also had some other qualifying diagnosis that qualified them for placement. ADD, again, not surprising. And roughly half of our kids have some sort of mood disorder. About 27% of our kids have anxiety or trauma, and most of those are kids with trauma diagnoses. And then you can see the smaller numbers, but some fairly serious, especially when you get to thought disorders. About 4% of our kids have a diagnosed thought disorder. Quick numbers about substance abuse. In our long-term facilities, we do offer substance abuse in what we call residential treatment units. Those are therapeutic communities within our long-term facilities where the kids are placed for between 6 and 8 months, and they do complete the intensive program utilizing 7 challenges. Kids can also receive that program on what we call an outpatient basis, so they could live anywhere on the campus of the YDC and still receive the same service, but live in a general housing unit rather than in that therapeutic community. So roughly 53% of the kids in our long-term facilities have a qualifying diagnosis, and about 37% of them were referred for our residential treatment units. So we have an electronic record, which includes not just the health and mental health information, but all the demographics, legal, et cetera. It's a pretty comprehensive record. And we've been fortunate enough to utilize this to help provide continuity of care among facilities and trying to track what the kids need. So, you know, connecting the services, doing some outcomes, internal outcomes research to see, are we using something that seems to be benefiting the kids? Is there something we need to enhance? It also allows us to do some quality assurance management and oversight from a central office sort of a level. We can go in and I can review any chart of any child in the state here from my office in Atlanta if I have any questions about that child's care. So utilization review is quite simple. We are also attempting to use our electronic system as part of our system of care management. There have been efforts underway in Georgia to develop a unified electronic record that would be consistent across state agencies, and we are working on that. So system of care is an invaluable component of what we do for our kids in DJJ, whether they are in secure facilities, in communities, or transitioning between the two. You know, we all know that criminogenic risk and criminogenic behavior is virtually never the only identified challenge that a youth faces. So our kids almost always are multi-system involved, and connecting those systems at the state and at the local levels is essential if we're going to try and get the best outcomes for our kids. Here in Georgia, we do that a couple of different sorts of ways. We have community-based system of care entities known as interagency planning teams, or LIPTs, and each county is supposed to have an LIPT that brings their county representatives to the table to discuss high-needs kids. And this was actually written into statute in a major, major juvenile code reform that went into effect here in Georgia in 2014. And the upshot of that code reform is that we have seen kids entering secure detention at about half the rate that they were doing before the code reform was implemented. So, knock wood, so far it seems to be working. In addition, at the state level, there is a state entity known as the Interagency Directors Team. That is essentially me for all of the state agencies in Georgia, those people who are in charge of children's mental health for their specific state agency. In addition, the IDT includes members of the advocacy community, private providers, and pretty much anybody that we can think of who plays a role in assuring that systems interconnect in a way that is supportive to the kids in our community. And that's me, Irene.
Hi, thank you. I was happy to see all the overlappers. I was just excited about that. We have a lot of overlap. Good afternoon. I'm Irene Valentine. I'm the director for Bureau of Behavioral Health Services here at New York State within the Division of Juvenile Justice and Opportunities for Youth, which is kind of the division under the Office of Children and Family Services that oversees the care of kids involved in juvenile justice. Oops, I didn't press it. I'm doing something wrong here. It keeps, wait. Here we go. So first I wanted to start by saying thank you just to all the participants, everyone who's on the phone. I wanted to thank you for being part of this webinar, particularly for those who are actually doing the work with kids who are involved in juvenile justice. It's really hard work. I was thinking about our staff and some of the things that our staff kind of talk about it being difficult. Our direct care staff get mandated. Our schedules aren't always the best. Like you were saying, we try to make sure we have coverage in the evenings or nights and weekends. So, it's difficult. It's a difficult work to do. And at any moment, we have some kids who can get really aggressive and dangerous. So it's a hard work to do, and our people do it every day. So for the folks who are doing it on the phone as well, I just want to say thank you. And for those who are advocating, we wouldn't be having kind of a nationwide movement if people weren't advocating. We wouldn't be having like this webinar, these conversations. I know kind of there's a nationwide reform, but it's also happening at every level that kids interact with the juvenile justice system, not just when they get placed. I know kind of in our neck of the woods, we've made investment in diversion, in community-based, programs, in doing better assessments when kids actually do enter the juvenile justice system. And I think Christy was talking about, understanding the impact of trauma and how kids are, multiply involved. And so that wouldn't be happening if we didn't have advocacy and all that occurring. So New York State, we have, over 4 million youth, and for 2012, we had 108 arrests of kids under the age of 18. We really don't get that many kids placed with us at this point. I think the state has done a wonderful job of really figuring out how we're going to divert kids from residential placement. And so about 3,600 kids get placed annually in New York State, and they do a very good job of trying to get them placed in other placements, not bringing them into our system. So sending them into our voluntary agencies so the kids are going elsewhere. Currently, within what we call the AJOI Division of Juvenile Justice and Opportunities for Youth, we get about 10% of those kids that actually end up residentially placed. So the youth that we serve are usually the ones that all the other agencies out there have said, nope, not it, we can't serve those. So as a result, OCFS get, we get some of the more complex, challenging youth and the ones that all the other child-serving agencies really said, we're not able to serve. So that's what's coming to us at this point. Similar to, because you were saying, we have kids with very high mental health needs, substance abuse needs. So our JDs are our juvenile delinquents, so they're the kids who are coming to us via family court, whereas our JOs are our juvenile offenders, and in New York State, those are kids coming to us via criminal court. And so I identify kind of the levels of substance abuse, mental health, kind of special ed as well, kids who are coming in for having committed a sexual-based offense and limited language proficiency. What's interesting is where you see where it says mental health, those kids, and we're excluding from that kids with kind of conduct disorder, ADHD, things of that nature, oppositional defiant disorder, so that's excluded. So these are more kids who are coming in with mood disorder, usually bipolar, schizoaffective disorder, or something along those lines. So those kids that are just coming in, almost all of our kids have a diagnosis of either conduct disorder, oppositional, something along those lines. So those kids are not being counted under where it says mental health. So we do have a very high number of kids with mental health and also kids who are coming in with a lot of trauma needs. Within our system, we currently, so within our system, kind of our reception process, there's actually a reception center for our kids who are coming in, juvenile delinquents, and those kids have kind of a 14 days that they're actually at a reception center, and during that time, that's exactly what they're doing. They're doing a whole host of kind of comprehensive psychological is completed at that time, and we're also doing other kind of medical, dental, vision. So those kinds of screenings are happening at the reception center for our JDs. Our JOs, who are processed via the adult system, those kids come directly into facility, and so their reception process is 30 days, and it happens directly in the in our secure centers, which is where our juvenile offenders are placed. So during that time, like I said, a comprehensive psychological is completed, and a determination is made regarding whether the youth actually needs a specialty unit. So the specialty units that are available within our system are either a mental health unit, a unit for kids who have engaged in sexually harmful behaviors, or a substance abuse treatment unit. So those are the three specialty units we have. We also do flag, and we also flag kids with intellectual disabilities, but we don't have actual defined units for them, unfortunately, which is something that we're still exploring, and we are training our staff and working better with kids with developmental disabilities. Some of the tools that we're currently using, and this is just kind of a smaller kind of snapshot of the tools that we're using. We do, we use the ADIS, the Adolescent Alcohol and Drug Involvement Scale, and that's more of a screening tool, kind of determine levels of substance use. We screen for depression, we screen for suicidality, we screen for trauma. We also do IQ testing, and in terms of screening for suicidality, we also use the Columbia Suicide Rating Scales, and those are actually available online, and our staff seem to like that as well. Those are some of the other tools we use as well. So this is just a timeline kind of how services occur in our system. So within 1 hour of a youth being admitted into our system, we do what's called a medical and mental health screen for immediate needs. And this can be done, this is usually done by one of our direct care staff. So it was developed by myself and our medical director. And it's very basic questions. It's sort of like, are you in pain? Are you in need of medical attention? Make sure the youth isn't hungry, you know, immediate needs, like, do you need to use the bathroom, are you hungry, whatever, we take care of those first, and then we check to make sure that, you know, the kid's not, you know, homicidal, suicidal, or in any medical kind of attention that the youth may need at that time. Are there any allergies, are there any food restrictions? For girls, are you pregnant, do you believe you may be pregnant, so we want to rule those out. So those are just for immediate medical attention, and they're kind of written so that the staff just has to read it and doesn't feel like they're doing kind of an interview that's going to be difficult for them. And it's very short, it's less than 2 pages, and it's just really, it flags kids so that they can refer them on to the next kind of provider who's going to see them, either mental health or medical, based on any identified immediate needs. Then within 24 hours of admission, we start what's called the individualized intervention plan. Usually that starts by nursing, and really we want to, at that point, what we really want to know is, if the youth requires a restraint, are there any medical things that we need to be aware of? So they'll usually flag a kid if there's, you know, any asthma, is there any a heart condition, is the youth pregnant, if there's, so anything of that nature would be flagged right away by our nursing staff just to make sure that that staff are aware of. That plan is constantly being revised based on information that we gain from kids. So later on, as it gets a little more meat, it also includes kind of techniques that they should use for de-escalating a youth, what a kid may have as their kind of safety plan, like what are the things that the youth identifies as that helps them to calm down and kind of re-engage with staff. So things of those nature then get added onto the individualized plan, but initially it really isn't, you know, kind of an immediate for staff what they need to be careful with. Within 72 hours, all of our kids are assigned a clinician, and at that point we basically, the clinician just starts a mental status with the youth, and that's completed along with just a suicide assessment. 3 weeks into their time in facility, we try and start what's called our integrated assessments, more like a psychosocial. If it's indicated, within 2 to 4 weeks, our youth is seen by psychiatry, and they have ongoing monthly meetings with the psychiatrist to renew their meds if it's indicated. Not every youth is seen by psychiatry. That's only if it's indicated. Our psychiatry time, I don't know how it is in other sections, but we have really hard time finding psychiatrists, especially in our facility. So it's we have very limited time, so we value it and treat it like gold almost. We're very careful with it. Within 30 days, our support teams are developed, and then every 30 days we have what's called kind of our treatment team support with the youth and family. Group counseling is offered daily, and each youth has a individual session with their therapist weekly. We're constantly thinking about where is this going to go beyond us. So our former commissioner kind of started this little slogan, think exit at entry, and that has kind of still stayed with us. We really are always thinking, like, what's next for this kid? And so we're constantly within the support team / treatment team thinking about where is this kid going to go next, and how do we prepare them for that. This is an example of some of the behavioral kind of health alerts that we try and make sure that folks are aware of when a kid enters our system. So some of the ones that, and not all of them are kind of on here, but some of the ones that you could see, in addition to the ones that are already up here, you can see we have also, we want to know if there's gang affiliation, that also we pay attention to. Is there a history of fire setting? Is there a history of AWOLing? A lot of the, if a kid's stepping down to a lower level of care, they usually want to know that. Histories of hospitalization, things of that nature. So we have a whole set of things of alerts that we try and make sure we identify, and that one that our team is aware of, but that we're also handing down to the next provider who's going to be receiving the youth. For every youth that comes into our system, we try and complete just a comprehensive psychological evaluation. These are some of the sections that are included. So, are there any special orders? What the reason for referrals are? Usually we try and pay attention to those special court orders if the judge, has made any informed consent. These are some of the tests that we use for IQ testing. I'm sure it's, kind of standard for folks. Stanford Binet, the WISC, the WASI. And then current functioning. When you look at the issue of adaptive function, we only fill that section out for kids who actually are presenting with a developmental disability, and then we want to know their level of adaptive functioning, because that then helps us to determine kind of where they're functioning and how we have to kind of interact or change our programming for that youth. And then it's pretty standard kind of clinical impression, diagnostic impression, summaries, and any recommendations. So that's completed for each youth in our system. So I think assessment is expensive. So I know in our system people were sort of like, oh, I remember when I came on, they weren't so excited about doing assessments. That was sort of a thing that they felt like, does every kid really need an assessment? Do we really need to? So we pushed really hard, at least from Behavioral Health Service, about doing kind of comprehensive assessments for all. We want a complete comprehensive assessment because we want to best understand, what works with this kid. And I think we were also pushing, like, if you want to get this kid out of our system as quickly as possible, because we have that flexibility in some cases with RJDs where we can get them out earlier, and if we figure out kind of what the needs are, get them onto the next provider. We have more of a flexibility in doing that. Like, we can get them out quicker if we really understand what the needs are. I think there's also, like, if we as a society kind of have decided to sort of take away this young person's freedom, then we really want to fully understand kind of what were the circumstances, what were the vulnerabilities. A lot of our kids, like Christy mentioned, have, are multiply involved. There's not just one system. They've been involved with, child welfare. They've been involved with special ed. They've been involved just with so many systems. But surprisingly, like, no one system has really stopped and really done a comprehensive, assessment to really understand what the youth and families' needs and vulnerabilities are, and their strengths. That's the other part. So we find it very helpful to actually have that information, because that comprehensive assessment really guides the treatment that we provide the youth and how we take care of them. One of the things that always surprises me is sometimes a kid comes into our system, and I saw someone mention about in the chat box about having a kid with a 45 IQ. Like, I'm always shocked when we're the first ones to find out that a kid has an IQ that low. Like, are you kidding me? This kid has gone through school, this kid has gone through all this, and now we're finding out that we have to refer him kind of to the Office of People with Developmental Disabilities. So some of that stuff is really surprising to me, that, that things like this do happen to kids in our system, even in our days. And then we also want to assist youth in kind of developing kind of a narrative and an understanding of their own experiences. We want them to have, you know, some insight into themselves and kind of make sense of themselves. Like, sometimes even, like, giving kids information about their testing really kind of surprises them almost, that they get to understand themselves, like, wow, that's why I do that, or, you know, kind of that information. And ultimately, it helps us to teach kids, kind of the pro-social behaviors we want them to learn. So we're really, you know, we really have a lot of value for assessments. So these are some of just the treatment components in our system. Like I said, every youth is assigned a clinician, and all facilities have access to psychiatric care as needed. Group counseling is provided daily, and these are some of the groups that we're offering. We're offering Sanctuary, which really is a trauma-informed kind of the trauma-informed psychoed groups. We use dialectical behavioral therapy. We use a skills group offered a lot of time by our clinician and our staff, and they also use DBT, dialectical behavioral therapy, for individual sessions. For the girls, we've also used this Girls Circle, which is a curriculum on girl empowerment and kind of has a lot of information on you know, different areas for girls. Seven Challenges is also the treatment modality that we use for substance abuse, and then we also use substance abuse prevention prevention program for our kids who are not involved with substance abuse, which quite honestly is not a lot of our kids. And like I said, youth and their caretakers meet with us every 30 days. And the last two support / treatment teams are really focused on discharge planning. That's the main focus of those treatment teams. I actually wanted to include this just because I found this part really interesting. We had I think sometimes people think, like, if you just get clinicians and you throw them into a facility, you know, find some clinicians, put them in a facility, and, you know, it all works out, it kind of gets figured out. But figuring out how to provide clinical services in a juvenile justice setting isn't always easy. I think it isn't just about putting them in there and kids get clinical services and it works out and that's the end of the story. I think you really have to figure out kind of a way of doing it and also kind of almost sell it to the direct line staff if it hasn't been part of your system. And for us in New York, it wasn't part of our system. I think, you know, providing a lot of clinical services is relatively new. I want to say probably within the past 7 years. So we actually had a what's called a scuttlebutt. It was kind of an engagement, kind of a team building activity with some of our staff. And what they kind of did was spend time with the operation side and then the clinical side and have them develop what do they consider components of therapeutic programming. And actually, this was a list of what overlapped. And I thought that was interesting, that both the clinical people and the operations side really shared from their perspective what they felt really created like a therapeutic programming. And so they, you know, they really talked about, you know, facilities being safe, you know, environments where people feel respected, having good communication, consistency, adequate staffing, clarity about their job expectations. Sometimes I think when folks don't know what to do, our clinicians in some cases have been used like not appropriately in terms of doing clinical work, so really figuring that out. Consistent supervision of both the youth and of the staff was a big one. Having intact teams, like the same kind of as much as possible the same folks working with kids, so that the teams are actually able to fully communicate with each other and not having those silos. Schedules that are realistic and adhered to. Relevant trainings. We get a lot of mandated training sometimes, so staff feel like, you know, that their trainings need to be kind of specific to the kids that they're working with, and supervisors that are visible, available, and can help them problem solve. So I just thought it was interesting just because it isn't just about like putting some services and it all works out for your programs to sort of have their therapeutic component. There really are other things that really we need to pay attention to in programming. So our kind of model that we use in New York is called the New York model, and it basically, you know, and it's not kind of rocket science, it's basically a mechanism for kind of the adults to communicate with each other and really support kids in growth and change. And to do that, to help facilitate that, we kind of have in each facility kind of a clinical lead, and it's the assistant directors for treatment who oversee the provision of clinical services. And they kind of provide coaching and supervision of staff and help guide kind of the operations in being clinically informed. That hasn't always been our system. We really were a more correctional model, so we're trying to move towards a more therapeutic. So having someone who kind of has that administrative lens but is a clinician has been very helpful in helping us move towards a more therapeutic approach. And so the model draws on kind of best practices of behaviorism, being trauma-informed, and kind of attachment theory. And so the practices are basically operationalized through the intact teams. And the idea is to have a consistent group of adults working with a consistent group of kids, you know, and trying to be as clinically informed as possible. So within the design of the New York model, kids, you know, kids are reinforced kind of, it's a point system, and we basically try and reinforce appropriate behaviors, and there are some incentives built into that, and kids want to move up the kind of what we call our phases. So if you're engaged and displaying kind of, you know, behaviors that, you know, are appropriate, then you get reinforced and then you move up in phases. The interdisciplinary teams, and these are the folks that are involved in usually in a kid's care team, and it includes a clinician, nurses, rec specialists, their case manager, direct line staff, teachers, and so they kind of meet collectively and really discuss the youth goal and also the progress that they've made towards their goals. And as I mentioned earlier, each youth has an assigned clinician and psychiatric services if indicated. One of the things we really wanted to also, I wanted to highlight was the issue of collaboration being key. I think a lot of times, you know, we feel like, you know, our agency takes care of these kids and so it's just our agency, you know. We've actually tried to open ourselves to really reaching out to what we call our sister agencies and developing those partnerships with kind of multiple agencies and looking outside and collaborating. And those have been very important to us. I think a lot of the kind of traction we've had in moving forward and finding staffing, figuring out how we're going to put things in place and getting services for our kids that we weren't previously available have happened as a result of our partnerships. And two of the ones that I think I wanted to highlight was our residential treatment facility for juvenile justice-involved youth, and that was developed in collaboration with our New York State Office of Mental Health and OCFS, and that was basically to provide what we call RTF level of care for our kids who are involved in the juvenile justice system, and that's sort of kind of for kids who have very high mental health needs. We also work very closely with OASIS, which is the Office of Alcoholism and Substance Abuse, and they actually were the ones that were able to identify seven challenges for us to provide treatment. We really were looking for a treatment program that worked well within the New York model and that was trauma-informed and developmentally appropriate, and we're having a really hard time trying to identify one within, you know, just by ourselves, and so they were kind of the ones that pointed us towards seven challenges. And actually were nice enough to offer us the initial training free of kind of the initial kind of staffing that we're training to actually offer it to us free of charge. So that was a nice partnership that came out, something great that came out of that. So I just want to encourage those collaborations with outside agencies because that's been very helpful to us. So really quickly, our RTFJJ you know, provides kind of individualized mental health services. It's considered a little less than restrictive than hospital level of care. It's really the first kind of its kind mental health treatment facility for kids in the juvenile justice system. And traditionally, those kids were not, they were excluded from what's called RTF level of care because of their criminal backgrounds. That was just an exclusionary criteria, so kids couldn't go to an RTF because of their, that was usually an exclusionary criteria, and so this allows kids to get that level of care despite having a history of engaged in criminal activity. And it's located, it's in Brooklyn, New York, it's called August Acorn Center. Okay, so the facility, it's very small, it only has the capacity to serve 24 kids. We're trying to expand it with more slots since we do have very long wait lists for this program. I sometimes tease that the kid won JJ Lotto when we can get him in the RTF because it's so hard to get him in because of the capacity issues. It is a co-ed facility. All the bedrooms kind of are on the same corridor and provide kind of easy access to supervision, and they have kind of annunciators, kind of alarms when the kids go in and out of their bedrooms. They have, you know, kind of a self-contained kind of unit. They have three units, three living units, eight each, as they said, and then they also offer kind of learning center, large activity room, conference room, indoor pools, so those type of things. So as I mentioned before, the youth that are served are usually the ones with more complex and severe mental health conditions. They have to be certified via the pre-admission certification committee, which certifies that they meet eligibility criteria, and it's a Medicaid-funded program, so they have to meet that criteria. They have to be what's called PAC certified in order to be eligible. And I think, you know, usually it requires a psychological, psychiatric, submitted to the PAC committee, which isn't internal to us, it's New York City PAC committee, and then they make the determination that the kid meets criteria based on kind of Medicaid eligibility standards. And the average length of stay is 9 to 12 months for those kids in that facility. Okay. And then kind of just in terms of wrapping up, I just wanted to say that one of the other things that we also found really important is, you know, kind of a good sales pitch and follow-up is it's been really hard to sometimes get our kids linked up to services once they leave our system. So we've tried to develop agreements with local providers who will actually are willing to take our kids. Our former chief psychiatrist had a story where she called a clinic to talk about the possibility of them accepting a kid, and the director of the clinic basically telling her, we don't even want your kids in our waiting area. So we were saying, if it's New York City, you can sort of maybe find another provider who's more willing, but in some of our rural areas, we don't have that luxury. Sometimes there's only one provider within a certain mile radius, so you have to almost, you know, try and sell how you're going to do that. Sometimes, you know, our aftercare folks will make sure the kid actually makes it to the first appointment, or we make agreements that will, you know, attend or bring the kid to them, you know, things of that nature to try and get local providers to actually willing to take our kids. We've also provided trainings and support to other providers so that they're, you know, so they'll bolster their capacity to take care of our JJ-involved youth. So one of the things we've done is our Bridges to Health waiver providers who take our kids, we've actually provided them with training on how to engage and work with kids with juvenile justice involvement so that they're more willing to actually accept our kids. We've also tried to identify, you know, a person who is willing to actually accept those referrals so that when we're calling, we're not making what feels like a cold call, but we have some linkages with folks, you know, who are willing to take our, and who the identified person is that will take the referral. That's been particularly helpful with our youth who have engaged in sexually harmful behaviors, since those kids are sometimes really hard to get providers to accept into their clinics. And then the other thing we recommend that's been really helpful to us is really attending the county mental health and social services meetings. They're often, you know, the same kids and families. So being part of just attending those county meetings has been really helpful in terms of getting kids, you know, linked to services, especially after they leave our care.
Good on my end.
Super. Thank you so much, Irene. So much great information. I was lucky enough to be able to see the RTFJJ, and I really wanted Irene to talk about it today because it was really stunning because the kids who are there are kids who really were not having any success in the regular state-operated facilities and kids who really hadn't had much success in most systems that they'd been involved in all along, and that to be inside that facility and see how well the kids in there are doing, how they have really found a way to help them thrive and really support them in a way that didn't really feel correctional at all was pretty amazing, considering that these were the kids who folks may have thought needed the highest level of security previously, but they actually were in a truly therapeutic setting that was clearly meeting their needs. It's really, it's a wonderful place. So I'm glad you all got the chance to hear a little bit about that. We are going to pop in on your screen a box where you can download the self-assessment tool about the connection between behavioral health and juvenile justice residential care. And also there should be a PDF of the slides from the presentation that pop up for you, and you can download both of those things, so you should have a copy of the slides The self-assessment tool, you'll see, has several different domains, and it asks you a bunch of questions to kind of rate how you're doing on lots of different pieces that really need to come together in order to strengthen your behavioral health services for kids in residential care. It's a tool that I think at the very least, if you walk through it, can help raise some awareness of all the different things to think about in structuring your residential care system to meet behavioral health needs. And in an ideal world, it could be a tool that you could use to sit with your collaborative partners and really think through where your strengths are and where your gaps are and give you some food for thought about where you might want to start really linking your systems of care with your juvenile justice residential facilities and maybe be a basis for some strategic planning for you. So I would encourage you to use that tool. And we also are offering, as this is more than a webinar, as this is a learning community, we're offering a chance for you to work with that tool or call in with any other questions you might have. On May 18th, from 1 to 2:30, you'll see the phone number, the participant passcode are here on this slide for you. And you can call during these office hours, and I will be on the line along with Irene and Chrissy, and you can have a chance to really have a conversation with these folks about questions you have, maybe things that came up for you in the self-assessment tool, or questions that you wanted to talk through in greater depth that come up for you from this webinar. So I would encourage you to mark that on your calendars and give us a call during those office hours if you want to really get into some conversation with the presenters and also with one another. I know a lot of you took the opportunity to introduce yourselves in the public chat box. I think that's wonderful, and it will really help us develop this as a community if you want to call in and have discussion with one another during the office hours on May 18th. So we got, we'll fly over to questions and answers at this point in time. We had a question many, many slides ago from Sharon Parsons, who had a specific case that she was looking for some advice on. So they recently got a resident with an IQ of 45 who has a history both of sexual abuse and being a sexual abuser and a history of fire setting. So probably one of the hardest kinds of kids to get in a residential setting. She's wondering if, Irene or Chrissy, if you have behavior plans specific for these types of kids.
Hi, this is Chrissy. And I went ahead and jumped into the chat because I didn't want to miss that opportunity since that's such a highly specialized question. Yes, we do develop behavior plans for those types of kids, and it's unfortunate that we're starting to see more and more of kids with that profile in our system as well. We can't use the usual cognitive behavioral interventions that we would normally use with sexually harmful behavior kids, but we have some curricula that utilize very simple concepts and utilize a lot of pictures. Footprints and healthy choices are both good curricula to use with kids with some cognitive limitations, and I went ahead and put the names of those two in the chat, so they're there.
Thanks, Chrissy. Irene, do you want to weigh in?
We have specialty units for kids with sexually harmful behaviors, so like we would put them in one. But I think, again, it's really hard to use kind of the CBT-based stuff. We do use our kind of a point system, and our point system really looks at, you know, what kind of things the youth is engaging in, you know, keeping hands to yourself, not touching other youth. So they would get points very focused on that. I'd also want to get a very good assessment of this youth, like, you know, with an IQ of 45, you know, what happened? We really would want a good understanding, because if you're ever going to set them down, you really want to understand that, and the fire setting, you know, a good fire setting assessment, just because that'll be huge in terms of stepping the youth down to any other setting. But we are also, I was just actually mentioning that we're also seeing an increase in kids with developmental disabilities, which I don't know if it's because we're paying better attention to it or we're just getting more. But we are definitely seeing an increase.
Thanks.
Yeah, that was Sharon, you cut right to like one of the toughest questions, right? For sure, tough cases, and hard to know how to do right by and meet all those needs and deal with all those risks too inside a facility. So, thanks for the question. Christy, did you want to say a couple words about the intensive treatment unit that you have in Georgia?
I appreciate that, Jackie. Yes, as Irene was talking about their unit, I realized that I missed an opportunity to include some information about our intensive treatment unit, which was modeled on the Mendota treatment unit in Wisconsin, and it's specifically for severely behaviorally disordered, but also kids who are severely behaviorally disordered, but also have significant mental health challenges. And it is a 30-bed unit that utilizes both EQUIP and SPARKS and a daily living program called Merging Two Worlds, and a very intensive point system. In most of our secure facilities, we utilize PBIS, positive behavioral interventions and supports, as our behavior management system. But at ITU, we utilize a program called Today Tomorrow that is a very immediate sort of reinforcement system. And the kids receive very intensive treatment. It reminded me a great deal of what Irene was talking about. And so far, we are actually seeing very good results. We've had kids earn their GED or their high school diploma who hadn't previously been making educational progress. We've had kids whose symptom severity has greatly reduced. We've been able to put in a program by which kids can apply to have gang tattoos removed before they discharge. And treatment progress is one of the criterion by which they are chosen. So I wish I had more time to share about that, because it's something that we're seeing some very, very good results on and we're very excited about. It's a very small unit. We have 20 treatment beds and 10 step-down beds, and we've been open for about a year and a half now. So very intensive CBT, very intensive behavioral, and so far so good.
Thanks, Christy. Maybe that'll just leave people hungry for more information to call in during the office hours. So, you know, that could be okay.
They did.
Yeah, that would be fantastic. So we're getting close to the end of our time. If anybody has any last questions, feel free to put them in the chat box. I do want to let you all know that the next learning community is going to be focused specifically on the connection of trauma and kids who are involved in the juvenile justice system. And that is going to be on June 16th at 3 p.m. We'll be sending out information to register for that webinar for the trauma-focused learning community, but I wanted to give you all a heads up about that in case you want to put that on your calendars now. I'm not seeing any other questions, so
someone had a question, I think, about education previously. I didn't see the whole question, but someone had a question about the role of education, and I think we were more, I know I was more focused on just mental health, just because that was kind of the focus of this, but education is a huge component in our system, and our, you know, our educational director would talk about, like, how much time is focused on our point system. You know, a huge portion of kind of our point system is focusing on kind of the behavioral needs that happen in the school system. A lot of our residents do have IEPs, and we try and make sure that those services continue to be provided. And we also do, we actually see a tremendous amount of gains in our system with kids educationally, and we are trying to work right now with state ed so that we can grant credits to kids, because what ends up happening is we offer the information and then the school district kind of makes a decision regarding the granting of credits. But kids in our system, you know, a lot of times will take, you know, their Regents exams for kids, and now we're calling it TAF. What used to be called the GED is now called TAF, so several kids take their TAF. But education is a huge component. I always tease that, you know, I always teach our educators that, you know, 6 hours of a kid's day is school, so if we take care of those 6 hours, that's, you know, 50% of the programming, because then after that, you know, the other 6 hours are again, then they go to sleep. So if we really take care of that, we're good. So I think we spend a tremendous amount, and the educators are a part of the kids' support team, so a huge part of education is incorporated in the youth kind of treatment when we're developing the treatment plan.
Great.
Thanks, Irene, and thanks for catching that question. It flew right by me. Christy, I don't know if you saw the question, but it's about collaboration and how education fits into the collaboration. Do you want to jump in on that at all?
Yeah, I sure will. I did see it, and I put a little bit in the chat just in case we didn't have a chance to circle back to it. So in Georgia, we are fortunate enough to be an accredited school system within our secure facilities, and we actually just got reaccredited 2 weeks ago, so yay our school. So our kids do continue to make educational progress. We have to be everything, elementary school, middle school, high school, and then we also have joint operating agreements for distance learning with colleges, universities, and we have technical colleges who come onto our long-term campuses. So we're able to transition kids in and out much the same way that any school would handle a transfer. Our school uses the same electronic educational record that the rest of the Georgia school systems use, so that piece has been pretty easy since we converted to that. One of the big system of care kinds of interaction pieces that we've had in the legislation that went into effect back in 2014, our community school systems were mandated by the law to engage in their local interagency planning teams that we discussed and to really become more proactive in staffing kids at the beginning when they were only minorly involved with juvenile justice or prior even to that where they were starting to exhibit some status offense behavior. And that has proved to be very effective. The retention rates of kids in schools has gone up quite a bit since then. We also have a program with DJJ, with the community supervision side. I didn't talk about that, but Georgia DJJ also handles the majority of community probation for the state. And we have a program by which we will place community probation officers in schools if the school wishes for us to do that. So the school provides office space, and we provide the probation officer. If there are kids on their caseload, they would see the kids there. But they're also there to consult and help intervene with kids that might not be JJ involved, but that could use some additional support, and our officers often participate in that as well.
Super. Thanks, Christy. I want to just give a heartfelt thanks to both Christy and Irene for doing this presentation today and also for being available for all of you during office hours on May 18th. Thank all of you for attending the webinar today, and really encourage you to download that self-assessment tool, work with it a little bit, and give us a call on May 18th so we can talk through things that you have questions about, things that you want more information about, things that you might be struggling with. Thanks very much. Bye-bye.